Hey guys, I'm Nashwa. Welcome back. And today I'm doing a wrap-up of all the books that I've read since July. The last wrap-up that I filmed was in June. And even though in my last video I said, oh, let me try to be more active, here we are 3 weeks later. I'm trying to be better. This is going to be my fiction wrap-up. I will have a non-fiction wrap-up because there's a couple of books that I'm trying to get through. So I want to do a consolidated video on that. So I have a few books to talk about. So let's just get into it. The first book I want to talk about first, because I did not like it and I just want to get it off my chest, so we can talk about the more exciting books that I read. So this is Darkdawn by Jay Kristoff, which is essentially the last book in the Nevernight Chronicles. Thank God for that. Which is, the Nevernight Chronicles is essentially a revenge story. It's about a 16-year-old girl whose father is assassinated or murdered by the state, and then she goes to an assassin school to become a ruthless murderer so she can extract revenge on all the people who killed her father. I was never one of the Nevernight followers from the beginning. I actually read the first and second book earlier this year so that I could read the third book and then I could have like one series done. So I was never part of the fandom that it was great. Like, I always knew what it was about, but like any very popular book, I found it to be extremely overrated. Now, the first and second book I did enjoy. The third one was very Bollywood to me. And if the term Bollywood is confusing to you, it's basically the film industry of India, and they do things in an extremely like overdramatic fashion, more dramatic than it needs to be. First of all, the plot in this book was extremely repetitive. Everything that Kristoff did in this book, he had already done in Nevernight and God's Grave. There was nothing new. The same old tricks came back into play, and I realized that the revenge story or the assassin school is not new to begin with, right? Like, that's nothing new. But then if you keep doing the same things that you did in your first and second book, it becomes old very quickly. There was a romance angle which I was just over with. Like, every time it came up, I was just rolling my eyes because like it wasn't necessary. It did nothing for the plot. It was just something that was used as fan service, and a lot of that came in the book, which I did not appreciate at all. Another thing that I really didn't like about this book was the characterization. I think what Kristoff tries to do is write morally gray characters, but he doesn't do it well. Now, with morally gray characters, they're supposed to be evil with like something good in them, or really good characters with like a little bit of dark side to them. Mia Corvier is one of those characters who pisses me off. Like, she really makes me angry, not in a good way. And like, her redeeming qualities did not exist in book 1 and book 2. But in book 3, Kristoff decided that, you know what this girl needs? Like, this murderous assassin, in his words, this murderous bitch, she needs a good heart. She needs a good heart where she is concerned about her friends. And all that is fine. If you showed that aspect of her to me in book 1 and in book 2, it would be more believable. But in book 3, it was just like, out of nowhere, we have this new character trait. And I'm like, what are you trying to do? Like, you're trying to show that this person is an extremely ruthless assassin. She will murder anyone who comes in her way. But also, she's crying about not wanting to hurt her friends. I mean, I don't buy it. And one of the most annoying things in this book was the writing style. Now, Kristoff has a unique writing style. He uses metaphors that no one else would use because a lot of the times they don't make sense. And he uses footnotes. So in book 1 and book 2, people would complain that like the footnotes are distracting, the footnotes like take you out of the story because you're reading it and there's a footnote explaining some random fact which does not really tie into the story. So people had complaints about that. And in this book, Kristoff decided to use the footnotes as a platform to address concerns of the reader, or mock them in a very condescending way, because he inserted himself into the story and he was like, who writes like footnotes in a story? And it was just done in a very annoying way. It was extremely self-indulgent because, Kristoff, you wrote the book, right? Like, we know you're the author, so there's no need for you to make your voice feel heard in the story. Like, you would be in the middle of an action scene and he would be like, hey, look at the footnote, look at me. And you read it and it's just like him on another tirade about how, like, you know, the people don't like the footnotes and his writing style. And it's just really annoying. Like, if you want to do that, why don't you write a blog post and share it on your Twitter or Instagram, where people can read whatever criticisms you have and address them, instead of inserting yourself into the story. That authorial voice, I think I heard it on someone's channel, they use this term. It was extremely annoying. It was just unnecessary. It took you out of the story. It really you. It took me out of the story. It really annoyed me. So anyway, I gave this book 3 stars initially because I thought at best this is 3 stars. But then I lowered it down to 2 or maybe even 1.5 after I started discussing it with people. And I'm like, you know what? This actually really pissed me off. So yeah, that was the first one that I really wanted to talk about because I did not like it at all. Next book that I'm going to talk about is called Tangerine by Christine Mangan. And this was a really fun book. I saw this on a lot of channels who read mysteries and thrillers, and it gave me a very similar vibe to Gillian Flynn because it reminded me a lot of Sharp Objects, which was much more of a slow burn thriller rather than a fast paced book like that. So anyway, this book is about two characters, Alice and Lucy, and they used to be roommates back in university or college, as it's written in the book. And then they were really good friends, inseparable, but then something happens and they fall out. Alice gets married, she moves to Morocco, to the city of Tangiers, hence the name of the book is Tangerine because natives of Tangiers are also called Tangerine. And Lucy just drifts into another part of the world, and then one day, out of the blue, Lucy just shows up at Alice's door, and you're like, wait, why is she here? Because they did fall out after an accident. So, like, why is Lucy here? And that's more fascinating because this book is set in the 1950s during the time of Morocco's independence. So it does put you at unease that, wait, how did she find her? Because it's not like you have Facebook or Twitter or other stalking mechanisms where Lucy just looked her up and found her. So it adds that element of mystery to it. And I really enjoyed this book. I think the plot was really done well because I haven't read a book like this in a while. So I haven't, like, I didn't know what to expect, but I didn't find it boring. I found it very creepy. I found it very intense. And about the characters, I have not read such a manipulative character in a while, and there were things that one of the characters was doing and I'm like, wait, what? How could you? Like, there's no way that you're doing this. So I really enjoyed it. One of the things that I would strongly advise against is that do not read the full synopsis that's on Goodreads or on the back of the book, because one of the things that happens in the book that's mentioned on the back, I'm not kidding, this happens at the 70% mark. So there's no way that it needed to be on the back cover or the Goodreads review, because initially when I read the synopsis, I read it and I realized, okay, this will happen at some point. But while reading the book, I forgot. And then when it happened, I'm like, wait, this is not really a surprise because it's already there at the back of the book. So what you need to know is that it's about two friends who sort of fell out because of an accident. It's set in the 50s, and there's elements of mystery, manipulation, extremely psychotic and dark characters. And if that's enough for you, then I think it's a good book to pick. I think I gave it 4 stars because I really liked it. The next book I read was called The Stone Gods by Jeanette Winterson. And for me, this sort of comes on the science fiction and dystopian spectrum. That's how I would define it genre wise, but I buddy read it with Britta and it was really fun because, again, this is not, I haven't read a story like this, but it's about a futuristic world where robots have taken over everything. Humans being exist, but they don't exist as we do. They have used technology to alter themselves. The women have fixed themselves at certain ages, so most of the women are 24 because apparently that's when women are at the prime of their youth, and the men have fixed themselves at age 30 or 32 because they still want to be like young and active and good looking. So human beings exist, technology exists. In the midst of all this, they have found a new planet which they want to inhabit because technology has completely destroyed this one. So they're looking for a new place to basically go and destroy. So I liked it because even though it's about robots, there's a very humanistic element to it. You think about things like, oh, what if the world was destroyed? Because climate change is so relevant these days. Well, not these days, but climate change is relevant. Wars are still a thing. And you do think that if World War III comes or if the planet is destroyed, like, what would become of the human race as it is? So this book has 3 stories, but it's divided into 4 sections. All of the stories are obviously interlinked with each other, but they're not a continuation of the same story. So you get a first story, and then you get a second story, and then the third and fourth story are essentially on the same timeline. So I really liked it. I also gave this book 4 stars. Now the next few books I don't have a lot to say on because I read them back in July, so my thoughts are a little muddled, but I'll try to like do my best to communicate them in a very coherent way. The first book from these 4 I'll talk about is Us Against You by Fredrick Backman, which is a continuation of Beartown. Beartown is about a small town in Sweden which is obsessed with ice hockey, and a tragedy happens and we're dealing with that. So Us Against You is 1 year after the tragedy. I'm still not going to tell you what the tragedy is because it's a major spoiler, and I feel like everybody already knows, but let me just try not to repeat it. So it's basically dealing with the consequences of the tragedy after 1 year. The town is still very much in denial or in a state of trauma where they don't really know what's going on or how to deal with it. The ice hockey club is suffering because there's like political elements involved. And the things that I really liked about this book, especially with Fredrick Backman's writing, is that I think when describing trauma and PTSD and things like that, like he really understands it. He really gets the community in such a way that even though this book is set in Sweden and if something similar happened here, like it would still be very much relatable, because he just describes it in a way which is very universal. So I really like that. I really like his characters. There were a few that I really liked from book one who are side characters, and book two I liked even more because they come to the forefront. So this book follows a character called Benji, who was the best friend of one of the main characters in the previous book, and in this he's like the front and center of attention. And because I liked his character traits so much in the first book, I really enjoyed it because he comes across as those like a really honorable character. He's really morally gray, like he's not the best person, but he's morally gray. He has negative traits, but I think they're delivered in such a way that I really really enjoyed it. So this book did make me sad. One criticism that I would have about it is that the first 50 pages were basically a review of what happened in Beartown. I feel like most people who read this book would have read Beartown, so there was no need for all that repetition. But I guess it was set up for those people who haven't read Beartown, which wouldn't really make a lot of sense because it's a sequel. But anyway, I think this was one of the best books I read in summer. I gave it 4 stars. Next book I'm going to talk about is one called French Exit, which is by Patrick Dewitt. I picked up this book because I read another book by the same author called The Sister's Brother back in January, and I really liked it. And this was my gateway into getting back into reading, picking up like a fun book. So essentially it's about a very rich woman, and her husband is dead and she is going back bankrupt. So she and her adult 32-year-old son and their cat basically decide to run from New York to Paris to avoid being bankrupt. And it was fine, like it was entertaining. There were elements that made me laugh. I don't really have much to say about it because I think like I enjoyed the first half a lot more. In the second half there were some absurdist elements, which I mean they're part of the story, and it's not like The Sister's Brother made a lot of sense in that way. It had some fantastical elements, so it was a good book. Like essentially I enjoyed the first part more than the second because the second one was like, I think this is getting a little weird. But it was good, it was fun. Like I gave it 3 stars because it was entertaining. Wow, that was such a coherent review, and I think that's all that I'm gonna say about that book for now. The next book I read was called Persuasion by Jane Austen, and I read this as a buddy read in Jane Austen July. So it's been a while since I read it, and honestly I did not rate this book. I think I left it unrated on Goodreads, and one of the reasons for that was that even though it was a buddy read, I fell behind. And I couldn't keep up with the discussion, so there was a lot that I missed, so I didn't really fully immerse myself into it. I found the first 50 pages to be extremely dense. I think there was a lot of like say scene setting and information just being there, and I'm thinking to myself, how is this how is this relevant? And then like with classics, because I don't read enough of them, I think it's a different style for me. So even though I finished it, I don't really have a lot to say about it, except for the fact that maybe I should read more classics. So every time I'm encountered by a book like this, I'm not like skeptical about getting into it. And because this was 4 months ago, I don't really remember anything about the story other than the fact that it was about a girl called Anne, and her father is going bankrupt and she is looking for a suitor. And I think Jane Austen fans are probably shaking their heads at me. So I'm just gonna leave it at that. The last book that I'm going to talk about is called Tooth and Claw by Lazlo Strangolov, which is basically a middle grade book written for younger kids. But like if I read this as a child, I would be terrified. Like not me per se, because I like horror stories, but like if a normal child were to read this, I think they would find it really scary. One of the things about this book is that, or about this author, because I really do enjoy his writing and I have another book up there, it's that even though it's for kids, there are very, very dark elements in it. So essentially this book is about a girl whose dog, Scud, is run over by a truck, And her father is really sad about this, so he's like, let me try to do something and fix it up. So he uses some sort of a science experiment to bring the dog back to life. Now the dog comes back to life, not in the way that it initially was. And the thing with the dog is that every time he sniffs a roadkill or a dead bird or something, that thing comes back to life. So that's like essentially the synopsis of it, which I found really interesting. It's set in a town which is basically a spa town. So like it has like hot water reserves, and they're using a lot, like they're using that to make beauty products, but they're testing it on animals. So even though it's for kids, it really does address like really dark themes, and into it they talk about like skin diseases that could emerge from it. So once the dog comes back to life and it's sniffing dead animals and bringing them to life, the whole town is really terrified as to what this devil is. And the girl Lumina, whose dog it is, she's really terrified to tell them that this is what's happening. So essentially it's like a story of adventure from there on. So I really enjoyed it. I also like the writing style in terms of how it's written, and then there's like really nice and creepy illustrations in it. So overall it was a good experience. So anyway, those are the fiction books that I read in the last few months. I would like to know what you think about them. And with that being said, thank you for watching, and I'll see you guys in another video. I hope you have a great day. Bye.